Amen. Well, good morning, church. I'll say that again because I don't believe that you believe that God's alive. I heard from this section here in the middle, but on the side, you're going to have to really participate here. And I'll say that again. Good morning, church. You believe that God is alive. Praise God that I'm alive this morning. Amen. Praise God that you have someone that is able to give you the word of God this morning. There's a lot of people that didn't wake up this morning and get this opportunity. So special it is to be with the family this morning. I love our new building. Do you guys? I mean, God has blessed us with the perfect venue. I want everybody very quickly to just take a look back. Why is this the perfect venue? Because we can fill it up with people. And when I think of filling this place up with people this morning, I think of filling it up with family. Family has been on my heart this past week. Family has been on my heart this past month. And I'm so excited to be with my family this morning. Very quickly, what I want you guys to do is take out your bulletin. And very excitingly, we've seen three added to the family in the last couple of months here. Let's give it up for everybody. It was so amazing to sit with Massimo and his County of the Cost study. And we sit down and we just make sure someone knows what they're really getting themselves into when they want to get baptized. As a Christian, right?
Yeah.
And I walked away from that Bible study with Massimo saying, you guys made a disciple.
Amen.
This guy is ready to go. So fired up. He sends these texts in the morning. Yeah. Where's Massimo at? Come on. I'll never forget seeing Oscar get baptized. You know someone by their character if you see them out there tagging.
Yeah.
And Oscar, call it glorified begging, it's called tagging. We fundraise just about every week, and Oscar was out there with his bucket asking for donations. And I knew in that moment, bro, that you are a man of God. I'm so grateful that you're here. Welcome to the family. And of course, we have our dear sister Antonia. Where is she at? Doing amazing things for us right now. I'm not sure what you knew you were coming to this morning, if you're visiting for the very first time, but you come to a church, to a fellowship, to a family that is fired up for our God and His mission. With that said, I'm so excited because we're going to have another person added to our family this morning. Where's our soon-to-be sister Vanessa? Right here. Seeing you there in the park when I was preaching and you walking up to me saying, you need to go and get my husband. She beelined me and said, you need to, I'm okay, I come all the time, I'm studying the Bible. I'll never forget that, but you need to go and get my husband. I'm so glad that you made this decision, the best decision of your life, amen. With that said, what God has put on my heart is a message entitled, Family Matters. Turn over to 1 Peter chapter 4. Family matters. Now for me, when I think of family, I think of aunts, I think of uncles, I think of cousins, I think of my mom, I think of my dad. And I'll never forget the warm summers down south, spending amazing time with my auntie Brenda in Wilmington, North Carolina.
Woo! Come on, bro.
The first time I discovered ticks was in North Carolina.
Yep.
Anyone is familiar with the bugs of the South? They don't play nice. I'll never forget being down south in Louisville, Kentucky. Some of you guys are like, where is Kentucky? Like, what goes on in Kentucky? So they have the Kentucky Derby every year, the horse races, but my family, the culture that I was brought up in, they just love to ride their motorcycles during the Derby time. And I'll never forget for the first time riding a real gas-powered It's amazing, like a dirt bike dune buggy. And I got in that thing and it didn't end up well.
No.
I ended up crashing into my cousin's neighbor's front yard. But when I think of family, that's what comes to mind. Great times. I'll never forget my summer in Knoxville, Tennessee. I have family all down south. They have, just for the record, they have some of the best food and some of the nicest people down south.
Yes, they do.
So I'll never forget going to, it was a chicken shack / car wash.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, some of the best things, exactly, 2-in-1. And I'll never forget, I had some of the best fried chicken in my life at a chicken shack / car wash.
Yeah.
So my uncle got his car cleaned, and I have a fond memory to share with you guys this morning. Now, very sadly, I joke about my childhood. Very sadly, that only lasted for 10 years. I put before you this morning that family is something that is hard for us to grasp and understand, which is why some of you guys were excited, and some of you weren't. With me here? So, those are the fond memories of age 10, but I'll never forget coming home from one of those summers and my parents said they would no longer be together.
Wow.
Sitting me down on the couch, trying to be strong in that moment, and yet everything I knew had came crashing down in 2 minutes. So the family that I once knew was no more. And I look at some of you guys' faces, I'm sure you can relate this morning. Not knowing what a true family looked like. I love my amazing wife. But when I started coming to church, I didn't believe in the true family of God. I didn't believe in marriage. I didn't think that it worked. And when I got baptized, I'll never forget going on my first encouragement date and seeing, encouraging a sister just in a pure way. I'll never forget seeing hope for the future. Hope for a true family. And in a million years, I never thought I'd be here preaching in front of you guys, in front of the family. And with that said, I'm very grateful and I'm very thankful to call you guys my family here this morning. I'm so proud of the Southland region. I'm so grateful to be part of the Southland region. And I really want to explain this morning one thing, that family matters. It doesn't matter how you were raised or your upbringing, what matters is how much family matters to our God in heaven. Just a couple quick scriptures here before we hop into our main text.
Come on, bro.
In Ephesians chapter 1, verse 22 through 23, the Bible reports, just write these scriptures down. I don't have time to go to all of them. Ryan gave me 40 minutes. I'll try my best. The Bible reports that God put Christ over everything, over all creation for the sake of the family. Meaning that everything was given to God. Just write these scriptures down and listen along here. We'll get to our main text here in a second. But God put everything over the feet of Christ, under the feet of Christ, for the sake of us, the family. Meaning what? The world is the way it is for us. The president we have is the way it is for us. The continent, the planet, everything is the way, everything in all creation is for us, the family of God. Some of us don't believe that this morning. I pray that I can convince you. In Psalm 133, write this scripture down. The Bible records that family is where God wants to bestow his blessing. Even life forevermore. So as you guys look around at the family of God, you guys are the blessing of God.
Come on.
This is the only place God wants to bestow his blessing. In Ephesians chapter 3, verse 10, write that scripture down. The Bible records that God wants all of his manifold wisdom to be displayed through the family of God to the world. This is huge. Manifold wisdom of God is displayed through the church, through the family. Meaning all of God's wisdom. How to love people. How to treat people. How to act. How not to act in a family setting. God wants that displayed to the world through us. What an amazing responsibility we have here this morning.
Oh, yeah.
The world is supposed to come into our midst and go, I know how to love because I know how Princeton treats his wife, George.
Come on.
I know how I'm supposed to treat a woman because I know how Princeton treats his sister, Princess. I know what a brotherhood is supposed to look like because I know how Princeton and Trey interact.
Come on, bro.
Implying that the world is lost without who? The family of God.
Come on.
Without the display of wisdom through the family, there is no hope for the world.
Come on, Princeton.
And one of my favorites, turn here to 1 Peter chapter 4.
Come on, bro.
In verse 17, we find a very important principle when it comes to the family. And I pray that it gives us a clear view of our responsibility this morning. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 17. The Bible reads, for it is time for judgment to begin with who? The family of God. And if it begins with us, what will the outcome be for those who do not obey the gospel of God? So here we find a great encouragement and a great responsibility underlined in this passage. God through Peter records that judgment will begin with who? The family of God. Now, praise God. As a minister, I don't live an easy life. I mean, when I get to heaven to be judged, I will be jumping up and down.
Come on,
will you guys be clapping and going, I just wanted a couple more years here? Or will you be clapping that you made it?
Come on.
Amen. So to me, this is a privilege. I get to be raised first. Well, raised to what? To be judged first. So here we have a responsibility. We're judged first. Just because we're judged first as family, does that mean we'll be judged accordingly as family? No. Is God going to judge the church as a whole, or is he going to judge you individually? He's going to judge you individually. So just because God raises you up on family day, which is judgment day, that doesn't mean what? You'll be judged accordingly.
Come on, bro.
To the family. You guys see where I'm going with this morning?
Come on, bro.
So what does that mean? If you truly want to be judged correctly on judgment day and risen with the family, you'll have to be what? Family. You'll actually have to be family here.
Come on, bro.
It'll break my heart on the last day when everyone's judged and we see all the amazing faces enter in and we see Jermaine because he's always so excited about God. And we see Tracy.
Come on,
and we see Oscar.
Come on,
and I'm not going to pick on anybody here, but we see another individual that doesn't make it. And I'm sure on judgment day, there'll be a lot of tears. Most will be for tears of joy. And then there'll also be some of sadness. Why? Because we'll see people enter in that weren't truly family in the church. We'll see people stand there, and guess what? Part of that will be on us. Because we didn't make them family. We didn't make sure they were family. And they weren't just plain church. That they weren't here just to feel good. But they were here to truly be the family of God.
Amen.
Two questions for you this morning.
Come on, bro.
And we'll answer them in the form of our points. Question one, are you family? Question two, what kind of family member are you? Question one, are you family? Question two, what kind of family member are you? For our text this morning, we'll be in 1 Peter chapter 4. I won't make you turn the page too much. Praise God, you guys were supposed to clap for that. But we'll pick it up here in verse 1. Point 1, in family, attitude matters. In family, attitude matters. And Peter writes to a church here that is going through a lot. I dare to say it's kind of like the church we're in this morning. I mean, when are we not going through a lot in our church? When's the last time Ron has not gotten an emergency call in wee hours of the night? Says no one, right? Never Ron Harding. When's the last time everything is just rainbow, sunshines, and butterflies? In your sleep, right? In your dreams. No. So Peter's writing to a church that is going through a lot. Most scholars would call this book the book of suffering. Because he writes to a church that not only is going through a lot, but it's suffering. We have early 60s AD. Do we know which emperor was on the throne here? Nero. Nero lit Christians on fire to fuel his feast in his garden. So I dare to say the church not only is going through a lot, but it's going through suffering. So put that into context as we read our first point here. And family attitude matters. Peter will later go on to be crucified by this emperor several years later. In verse 1, therefore, since Christ suffered in his body, arm yourselves also with what? The same attitude. Because he who suffered in his body is done with sin. As a result, he does not live the rest of his earthly life for evil human desires, but rather for the will of God.
Come on, bro.
For you have spent enough time in the past doing what pagans choose to do. Living in debauchery, lust, drunkenness, orgies, carousing, and detestable idolatry. They think it is strange that you do not plunge with them into the flood of dissipation, and they heap abuse on who? On you. But they will have to give an account. They'll be judged too. To him who is ready to judge the living and the dead. For this is the reason the gospel was preached, even to those who are now dead, so that they might be judged according to men in regard to the body, but live according to God in regard to the spirit. See, what Peter is trying to communicate in short here to the church is that in the family of God, regardless of what's going on from the outside, we have a responsibility. And what is our responsibility? It was the same responsibility that Jesus had. And I love it. Jesus wouldn't call us, the Bible wouldn't call us to do something that Jesus hadn't already done. Praise God for that example. Amen. Therefore, since Christ suffered, and just got done talking about Christ being seated at the right hand of God. So therefore, Jesus is in heaven. He also suffered in his body. So we are supposed to arm ourselves with what? The same attitude of Jesus. Can you imagine that? We know Hebrews records that Jesus was tempted in every way. But did he ever sin? Jesus never sinned. But I put before you this morning the suffering involved with doing the right thing in the midst of all hardship and suffering is not easy. So we're supposed to arm ourselves with that attitude. Now, I watch a lot of movies. And so when I think of arming myself, I think of putting on armor for what? You guys ever watch some medieval movies right there? We have any gladiator fans?
Yup.
I'm sure everyone's watched an action movie, right? So you know the part where he's getting ready to go down. And everybody's grabbing arms. And it pauses for a second in slow motion. And this last guy just wraps himself with a sword, and you're like, I'm that guy. That's the guy I want to be. Well, how many of us walk out of our house like that this morning? How many of us take this mindset on as we prepare for our week?
Come on.
Like we're arming ourselves, like we're going to war.
Come on.
And that's what the Bible is recording here. What are we going to war against? Well, verse 2, it says we go against our earthly desires.
Yeah.
I don't know about you guys, but I am an earthly man without God.
Oh.
I sold drugs. I am not the guy that thought I'd be preaching 7 years later. Some other evangelists get up here and go, I wanted to be a preacher all my life. Not me.
Come on,
I didn't even want to go to college. I had no aspiration to go to college. But yet, in my flesh, I'm very aware of who I am, an earthly man.
Yeah.
You know, you hear the song on the radio and you go, oh, that's a nice beat. Until you listen to the words and go, whoa. And you can do one or two things. Turn it off or listen, right? And that's why a lot of people get down on me because I listen to Coldplay, but that's why I listen to Coldplay. It's mellow and they don't cuss. And it's kind of spiritual. But your earthly desires war against what? In verse 2. It says the will of God. And that's what I have to ask you all this morning. Do you understand the will of God on a desire level? 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 3 records what the will of God is. Can you guys quote it? We should know it. You guys know what it is? For all men to be saved and come to a knowledge of what? The truth. And if you don't understand that this morning, you will always war against the flesh and the will of God. Because you don't know it.
Come on, bro.
You guys with me here this morning?
Yeah.
Come on, Prince.
And you have to choose very simply this morning, is your attitude going to be like a pagan? And I don't have to go into detail as far as what the pagans were involved in. We know this sin list. But is your attitude going to be like a pagan or that of one of Christ? You guys with me here? For me, I have to confess that this has not been my attitude for the past couple of weeks leading up to this point.
Come on, bro.
I'd say this past month or so. I've had a bad attitude. My attitude had been one of pride. My attitude had been one of selfishness. My attitude had been one of arrogance. And sadly, I started to, in my thinking and in my attitude, destroy the very thing that I love the most. And that is the family of God.
Come on, bro.
I was maybe sharp with some of you guys. I was maybe frustrated with some of you guys. Maybe I was easily angered with some of you. And it was all from my attitude. I took on this role of the earthly desire. And what's the earthly desire all about? Really, it's all about you. It was all about me for these past 3-4 weeks. And I'm very grateful for a man like Ron Hardy really sitting down with me and having not just one talk, but multiple talks until the theme of God and His will was communicated to me.
Yeah, come on.
Until I was safe to be that family member that God had called me to be. So I want to apologize to the church. If any of you guys felt that for me, I am repentant of it. And I am striving to be the best brother. This is the only time in church I'm going to ask you guys to pull out your phone. Unless you're taking notes. But I do want to illustrate something for us this morning. Ron should have texted the whole entire congregation a link. You guys have it?
Yeah.
Okay, so on the count of three, we're going to start it, and we're going to watch it together. And sadly, this is what can happen if we don't understand this concept that Peter is trying to communicate to us this morning. All right. I got mine pulled up. Let's cue it up. All right, that's it. All right, you guys ready?
Wait.
If not, just follow along with somebody.
Just count to three.
You guys got it?
Yeah.
Okay, most people got it?
Yeah.
Follow along. Okay, you ready? 1, 2, and 3.
tuned.
Only once in church will you be able to pull out your phone, so put your phone up, amen. But sadly, as I reflected on my attitude, and not arming myself with the attitude of Christ, but of the earthly nature, I was reminded of Dennis the Menace. And some of us, we use our attitude to bring harm versus good. What did Jesus do with his attitude? He changed the world. He changed everybody for the better that he was around. But yet some of us, like Dennis the Menace, we take our attitude and we sling it back.
Amen.
Like a slingshot.
Come on, bro.
We don't care who's in front of us. We don't care who's around. We pull it back, and what does it do? It destroys. It bounces around and it hits that sister and that brother. And it destroys this talk. And it destroys that relationship.
Come on, bro.
And we destroy the very thing we got baptized into. The family of God. Harm or injury. And the most powerful one, I believe, is that of the attitude. Why? Because all sin starts with attitude. Which is why he goes on to say, you spent enough time doing all of these things. Remember your attitude, or you'll fall back into the same lifestyle of a pagan. Where does lust start? Your attitude, your desire is not godly. Where does debauchery start? Your attitude. What you want is not, it's not a desire of God. So if we want to be the family that God wants us to be this morning, it all starts here.
Come on, bro.
In our minds and in our hearts. Take a look at your bulletin. And if you open it up, we have, I believe, some of the most helpful documentation when it comes to having the right attitude. And our brother Mark Hardy put this together some time ago. And it basically overviews all the stinking thinking claims.
Yeah.
All the attitudes, in a sense, that aren't Christ-like are godly. Amen. And I don't have time to go into detail. You have the bulletin, that's why we hand them out. So please go back and look at them. But what I like to do this morning is add a couple attitudes on for us. You guys with me here? And the first attitude I thought I'd throw on here is the attitude of being a customer. The attitude of being a customer. We live in America in the 21st century, and the customer's always right. If that was true a couple years ago, it's very true. I'm not sure what the specific title of this generation is today. But the customer is always right. To where you walk into a restaurant and tipping is almost unheard of now. I'm just saying, tipping is most people think tipping now is optional. And so in the minute you sit down, it's almost like, if you do want to give a tip, you're almost evaluating whether or not to give her a tip based on the quality of service you get. So you walk in the door, and if the air doesn't feel right, you're like, minus a dollar. If the waiter doesn't seat you in that booth that you like, minus a dollar. If you sit down and they don't come to take your order immediately, water and food, drinks and what would you like to eat, they don't take it together anymore, we're in trouble. I tip my hat off to anybody in customer service. It is not easy. If the food doesn't come out on time, if it's not hot enough, I mean, we're just looking for a way to take a bite and then give it back. And get a whole new plate of food. Or not pay for what we got. Hey, do I have to pay? Is that a hair in there? Okay. I don't have to pay. But sadly, so this is the generation. I put this in the new generation category, but it started to go from bad to worse in my generation. I did tip occasionally. But sadly, some of us bring this into the church. Some of us bring this customer attitude into the church, and it's almost like we want to try before we buy it. I don't know. I see the truth here, and I see everything the preacher is saying here, but is he safe?
Come on.
Ooh.
Come on, Princeton.
Ooh.
Is he, it's almost like, you know, you got that one eye right there. I don't know what that's called. Is that the evil eye?
The critical eye.
The critical eye. And it's almost like, is he safe? Is he gonna hurt me? Is he perfect?
No, baby.
Am I Jesus? No, I'm not Jesus. I am not perfect.
Say that.
Is he probably gonna make mistakes?
Yes, I will.
That guy who's mentoring me? I mean, my Bible talk. Are they just a bunch of derelictal individuals? Yeah, you are in that Bible talk. You are in that small group. Don't forget. You guys with me here?
Yeah.
I mean, do I have to really tip? I mean, do these guys, like, do they want my money? What do they do with my money?
Oh, man.
Like, where's my money? Are we really going to all the places we say we're going to?
Talk about it.
And slowly but surely, what the church starts to become are a bunch of customers.
Yeah.
Come on.
People who have no concept of ownership. People who see a problem but criticize the problem versus being the solution to it. People who don't trust because God hadn't brought them to this place of the family anymore. And why does that happen? Because we get hurt at times.
Yeah.
Would you guys agree?
Yeah.
How many times have you been hurt and went, I'm never liking anybody ever again? I've been hurt. I've experienced hurt. But yet in the church, what happens is if we don't push past our hurt, we hurt people.
Yeah.
The very attitude of hurt becomes our license to sin in the church. To miss the mark in the church. Well, I'm hurt, so I have the right to be this way. Well, the attitude of Christ was one that he died to his sin to the point where he never did it. What should be our attitude? Do we deserve to have an attitude? What if Jesus truly, what if Jesus got hurt and got an attitude at the cross? Probably would have destroyed, the earth probably would have been split in half in that moment. Like, if Jesus even got the inclination of an attitude, just the earth just split in half. But yet he refrained himself for you and me. I have a couple challenges for us this morning.
Come on, bro.
And that's to take ownership of what we have here in our church. Your small group, your Bible talk, you are supposed to take ownership for it. If something goes wrong, it is your job to fix it, not to criticize. We have to get back into the habit of confessing our shortcomings to each other. Our sin. You're responsible for that. We have to get back in the habit of communicating daily with each other.
Amen.
Bro, how are you doing? Sis, how are you doing?
Amen.
What was your day like? What did you read in your Bible this morning? And I want to challenge the members here to invest in leaders' meeting.
Yes.
Invest in leaders meeting. If you feel like there's just even the slightest bit of unsureness, or if you're unsettled as far as what we're doing as a family, Come to leaders' meeting. Guess what? It will all be explained in detail. But if you don't come to leaders' meeting and your attitude isn't right, then sadly you're not a customer but an owner. Or sadly you're not an owner but a customer in the kingdom of God and the family. So put your desire where it counts, guys. And that's towards seeking and saving those who need us so desperately. The will of God. I throw back out the challenge of the year. And that's to be personally fruitful. See, every time that we have to engage in a bad attitude here in the fellowship, we could be studying the Bible with a non-Christian. Every time there's several individuals that have to be involved in a bad attitude conversation, some of our best Christians, they could be out doing some of the best work. Studying the Bible.
Come on, bro.
With others. And so I give you this challenge, one a day, one a week. Share your faith with one person a day walking out of here. Be in one Bible study a week walking out of here. Put your attitude where it counts and where it matters. On the loss. And I pray slowly but surely we'll be a family that has attitude that matters, because we'll see a lot of people being added to the family. And close here, point two. Only have 2 points for this morning. In family, love matters. First Peter 4, verse 7. First Peter 4, verse 7. In family, love matters. The end of all things is near. Therefore, be clear-minded and self-controlled so that you can pray. Above all, love each other deeply. Because love covers over a multitude of sins. Offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. Each one of you should use whatever gift he has received to serve others, faithfully administering God's grace in its various forms. If anyone speaks, he should do it as one speaking the very words of God. If anyone serves, he should do it with the strength God provides. So that in all things God may be praised through Jesus Christ. To him be the glory and the power forever and ever. And the church said, amen. Very quickly, to close out here and to hit our second point. Peter puts before the church that love will cover over a multitude of sins. But first we have to have the right mindset, and that starts in verse 7. He says the end of all things is near. This was 2,000 years ago, so does this still count as the end being near here?
Yeah.
Absolutely. So because that Jesus is coming back, and we're not sure when he's coming back, the end is near, we should what? Be clear-minded, self-controlled, so we can pray. And love each other deeply, and he says, above all. So if you missed everything I said, for these past 20 minutes, you have to get this. Above all, love each other deeply. Because love will cover over sins. What's he getting at here this morning? It won't be the outside forces that crush the church or destroy us.
Come on, bro.
It won't be any outside force. And again, in context here, the church was going through a very tough time. You can knock at the door of a Christian, and they can be drug out and tortured. But Peter says, guess what? We can only destroy ourselves. Love will cover over sins.
Yeah.
You guys remember that promise that Jesus gave Peter in Matthew 16? This is the same Peter that writes here. He gave Peter the keys to the kingdom, and he said, Hades, hell can't overcome what we have. Hell can't overcome the family. But he does highlight something here that will destroy us, and that is our sin, our shortcomings.
Yeah.
But praise God, because he gives us the way to overcome it.
Right.
And that's loving each other deeply. And then he goes, if anybody's confused as far as what love is biblically, he goes into detail. He talks about offering hospitality without grumbling. One very close to my heart, he says in verse 10, use God's grace in his various forms. Use the gift that God has given you. And we have one special gift I really want to highlight here this morning. We have one special gift we've been given as Christians in America. And that is the gift of America.
Come on, bro.
Praise God. We live in America. We can walk outside, we can preach, we can teach, as long as we're not disturbing the peace. We can have Doolin's Soul Kitchen right there up in Manchester. I love it. And yet we take for granted our very gift. And I'm speaking mainly here to the family this morning. We have to have the right attitude, and we have to have the right level of love. Why? Because there's a world that needs us so desperately. So what gift have we been given? America. With America comes what? Resources. People, there's a lot of people here in America. And what else? Finances. Money. Amen? And I think about all the responsibility we've been given financially in regards to special missions. I pray you guys are excited. I pray that the gift you guys have been given will be put to work. You may look at me this morning and go, I knew he was going to transition and start talking about missions, and I knew. I don't feel like this is a gift. Well, let's get into some economic stats here. The poverty level in America is still wealth in 99% of the rest of the world. So if you're sitting here this morning and you're a member of the church and you go, I am poor, which I totally fall under the poverty line. Praise God. Fired up. I'm not talking. I'm definitely talking to you guys as a peer here. But if we've been given welfare in America in the sense that we fall below the poverty line, it's still wealth in 99% of the rest of the world. Meaning what? You can go to the majority of any other country and still be a rich man and a rich woman. Which is why we do all the things that we do. Acts 4, 32 to 37, we know that the first century church met the needs of the individuals in the church. We know that if there was a need, people sold their homes, people shared resources, people gave so that no one would be in need. And sadly to say this morning, I'm not sure if we all understand that basic principle when it comes to church building. Because there's individuals around the world right now, brothers and sisters, that are in need. What will destroy the church? What will destroy the family? Us not loving our brothers and sisters deeply, covering over the sin. So can you imagine some of the missionaries on the mission field right now? What they struggle with? The same things we struggle with without the comfort of America. Without what we have. So I can only imagine all the temptation I get here living in America. But the temptation they get on the mission field, the sin that haunts them, I'm not sure if we can really grasp this morning. But guess what I do know? I want to love that brother, that sister over on the mission field deeply. I want my love to cover over their sins so that they can get the job done. Take a look here at your bulletin. On the back we have the crown of thorns. And I'll close here with this. If you take a look, the last phase one church planting is Hong Kong, China. I'm so proud of the campus and everybody who's fundraising. Everyone who goes out and passed, because that tells me you understand that this is not just something on a piece of paper. This is a divine family matter that we do, meeting the needs around the world because we have the resources to do so. America has the most millionaires in the country. And you guys may look around and go, well, the money's not in my bank account. The money's not, it's definitely not in my bank account. But guess who does have the money? The millionaires that live here. So what do we do when we tag? When we glorify begging? We tap into the resources that the country has. We tap into the resources of the individuals that do have it in their bank account. And we give it to those in need. And when I think of the last church planting here in Iran, Hong Kong, China, that will be a day where we hear the first sermon preach with the right message. In Hong Kong, China, we're out fundraising and people go, "You're going to China?" I go, "I'm not going to China." But our church is going to China. Our family's going to China. And that's why we're out here in the blazing hot sun giving you armbands. Faith, hope, and love. And lo and behold, people give. Why? Because they want to be a part of the family too.
Yeah.
People are blown. They know that communist is China's communist. They know that this is the gateway to communist, to mainland China. And you're going to China? Absolutely. And I have to ask you this morning, are you on track to hit your missions?
Come on.
Is your level of love so deep for the family of God? Project Eagle is coming up. We have all the churches that are going to be planted in the U.S.
Yes.
And praise God that we have family members all over the U.S. But I'm excited because that means more money for the foreign mission field.
Yeah, come on. Yes.
Right? We make other churches in America just like L.A. And we have resources, abundant resources, to win the world in our generation. The number six most expensive building in the world is the One World Trade Center in New York, New York. It stands where the World Trade Center stood on 9/11. Sadly, we know the tragedy of 9/11 and everything that happened in that moment. But yet we saw something great in that moment as well. We saw a nation pull together. As a family, it wasn't a white thing, it wasn't a black thing, it wasn't an Asian thing. Everyone was patriotic for about a whole year. Now, amen, we need God, but... It costs America $4 billion to rebuild the Freedom Tower, the New World Trade Center. $4 billion. Do you think there's a taxpayer complaining about some of their taxes going to the New World Trade Center? Absolutely not. Do you think that anybody would complain about us as a nation, in lieu of what happened, spending $4 billion on a sign of hope for our nation? Absolutely not. Why? Because most people love their country.
Yeah.
Most people will die for their country, which is why, praise God, if you've ever served in the armed forces, people go to war. But this morning, we are not Americans first. We're Christians first.
Right.
Yeah.
We're disciples first. We're the family of God first. So if people don't argue and complain when their taxes go to the Freedom Tower, we should not complain about us loving our brothers and sisters in the form of missions.
Yeah. Come on, bro. Come on, bro.
If we suffer, we will suffer together. In verse 12,
come on.
Dear friends, do not be surprised at the painful trial you are suffering, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice that you participate in the sufferings of Christ, so that you may be overjoyed when His glory is revealed. See, don't think it's strange when you suffer. In Christianity, when you suffer, you're actually doing something right. For the most part. We cause ourselves unnecessary pain at times, but for the most part, if we suffer, you are doing something right as a Christian. Now, here's what we need to learn as a family. We need to suffer together way better.
Come on, Princeton.
We have to suffer together. So guess what? I'm just as challenged as you guys are when it comes to missions. But I am going to die trying to serve my brothers and sisters. Will you die with me? Will you suffer with me? I am going to die trying to fight my attitudes. My earthly desires. Will you die with me? Will you come and confront me if I have the attitude?
Yep.
Do you love the family that much?
Come on.
Isn't that important to you? Some of us right now are down in regards to our Bible talks and our small groups and our house churches. Suffer with them.
Come on.
Fix the problems.
Thank you.
Have the right attitude. Have the right love.
Come on.
I have to cut it short there. But I pray that walking away here, we have our responsibility in regards to family this morning. Write this scripture down, Isaiah 53, verse 3. The Bible records that Jesus was a man that was familiar with suffering. And as a family, we can't undermine that very aspect of the scriptures, but yet we have each other. And praise God, I pray that we can have a family where our attitude matters. We can have a family where our love matters. And in turn, we can be the family that does matter for God. And to God be all the glory.